involved in the project as a Spanish partner of REACH. So I now give the floor to Alvaro. Okay, the screen is already shared. Okay, so Pablo, the floor is yours. I have this presentation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, perfect.
Okay,
fine.
Let's try. Un vero piacere essere qui. Chiedo scusa per parlare l'inglese. Forse alla prossima volta. Well, it's very difficult to speak last, almost last, but even more difficult after Pablo and the cathedral, so I'm going to try to speak quickly somehow. It's a completely different approach to conservation. I'm not a trained conservator restorer, I'm an archaeologist, but I'm working in conservation also in some ways. We are always working in conservation. If archaeology is not conservation, then it is not archaeology. That's my approach. And I'm going to present like a huge approach, like we are from the microscopic scale and now the cathedral, the site, the Nuraghi, and now the mountain. I'm going to talk about the mountain. So it's about the site, but specifically in a place in Galicia. It's of course, it's with my colleagues, my friends, and thank you very much for inviting us, Mariangela, Sara, Tania, and everyone in the REACH project, the Albanian people and people from Urbino, everyone. Apart from that, well, the Erasmus Plus project is working a key role here, and of course, the local community I'm going to talk about, and the private company of archaeology involved with us. I want to talk about different issues, different objectives, quite complex, but first, what it is archaeological conservation, if it is something, then something about free tools and free software and so on, so, trying to talk about landscape and, of course, community, social community and people inside, people related to archaeological sites, how they approach their heritage, and a little bit about immaterial heritage. I work as an anthropologist too, so I'm involved in ethnographic heritage. So, as you can see, it's completely different from what we've seen, but I guess it's complementary somehow. The first question is there really a proper archaeological conservation? In Spain there is, we have one specialization in archaeology, but in many countries there is not. Like you are specialized in glass, metals, in pottery, whatever, but not in archaeology. So it's sometimes it's difficult because the archaeological work in conservation in sites is done by archaeologists or architects or engineers, but not from conservators. So it's really sometimes a problem if it is a profession, when to learn about it and so on. And in fact, the paradox is like archaeology means destruction. We are, as archaeologists, we are doing a destructive analytic technique. We are recording the site, we are keeping the movable objects, but we are destroying the relationships between them. We are, of course, destroying the site if there is a building or highway, whatever. But even when we take out, when we excavate, we are destroying the site forever. You know, we keep some information, but not all of it, for sure. So sometimes archaeology means destruction and conservation means conservation. So it's like different worlds. No? This is a picture from yesterday and it was very funny because I'm not criticizing, but it was very funny because here in the shelf there was like restauro and archaeologia, you know, like going different ways. And it's quite common. This approach is quite common. Of course, I'm not criticizing. I completely understand it. But we need to try to, to be together, no? Yeah, of course we are. So, also, being an archaeological conservator, we need to be, to study specific glass and to be specialized. You need to know your materials, you need chemistry, you need very, very specialized knowledge, but from the archaeological point of view, you need to think from the big approach, like everything. So it's very complex, this relationship between particular and universal. I'm going to try to talk about this now. Specialization versus the reality of the destruction of archaeological heritage. So, and archaeology is a very powerful, in some ways, tool for society and for culture and for people. No? That's what I'm going to explain. This one, well, I'm going to talk about them later. Material heritage, community, so on. This was a project led by, well, there it says community, school, our school, local community, and the students. They were a key part of the project because they blended with the local community and they created this project. In fact, the professors helped, but it was the students also. No? Here it is, Galicia. Here it is, Galicia again. It's not, well, the mountains are not huge. It's very hilly, but it's quite plain sometimes. And well, the place is there. Santiago is here, Pontevedra is here. It's like it's sort of a region, and it's a region called Deza, and this range of mountains close by this river, and then there is this mountain here, this mountain I'm going to approach, Monte do Carrio, and well, we were there almost by chance because the local community approached us, well, why don't you study this thing, we have rock art, we have megaliths, come here. So the question is, the place, it's this mountain. And there was a wind farm there. So we tried to do some kind of diagnosis of the archaeological heritage after the construction of the wind farm that was one of the first in our region. And well, how the state of conservation of the sites was, how was the inventory, how was everything. And well, in fact, some parishes, regional parishes, they collide or they are together in the it's like a, not a sacred mountain exactly, but it's for every different parish around it, no? And it was this community, here who called us to work with it. And in fact, in the beginning, the job was paid by them because of the money coming from the wind mills, from the wind farms, from hiring the land to the, it's a communal property here in Galicia, mainly most of the mounds are by way. So I'm going to talk a little bit about inventorying archaeological sites because this is a complete revolution for archaeology. From, of course, the tools are there from a very long time ago, like GPS and everything, and laser scanning and so on. But in the past, there was, well, the military US, they kept selective availability. So for non-military uses, the GPS was it was restricted. There was a mistake, intentional mistake applied on it. No? So until 2000, the tool was restricted. And from then on, we have a new tool, and we have, of course, LIDAR, laser scanning. We were talking about this. But also the laws, because from 2007 there is a law for spatial information in the European Community, INSPIRE, that means that this kind of information has to be shared and communicated. No? And of course, LIDAR and the tools. Nowadays, if you have the last iPhone, you have a LIDAR on your iPhone. If you have a mobile, you have a thermal camera sometimes. Tools that were so expensive like 5 years ago, nowadays it's like 500 euros maybe, or 1,000 euros is nothing. So technology is running so fast that we are like trying to run with it. No? And soon, with a drone and a LIDAR, we will be able to do something that nowadays it's it comes from the public, from the state. It's, well, you put a laser from a drone or maybe a plane, and then some points, a cloud point, and then There is an algorithm calculating this is low vegetation, this is medium vegetation, this is a house, this is a highway, whatever. And in the end, the algorithms are improving, and then you get the soil, without grass, without anything. And for us, it's like a revolution in many countries, but for us, more because we have a huge forest covering our surface, and vegetation is very difficult to see the sites. So we get two different models: the digital surface model with all the cloud point, and you get the digital terrain model with only the soil. And the you can do some archaeological survey from your house without going out. That is quite a bad idea, I have to say, but you can do it. And now you have the open source tools. And Laura Baratin talked about ArcGIS. Of course, if you need something strong, you need private resources. Of course, Gianna Bertacchi, I think, talked yesterday about the using private software also, because if you need a strong computing activity, you need them. But for most of what we do, we with free tools, open source, not because they are free, not because they have no cost, but because with them you can control which kind of parameters you want to use, and you have more freedom to use them in any or other way. And from now on, there is another directive from the European Union from 2019 on open data and the reuse of public information. This kind of information is getting public. Well, this is the introduction. So this is the place, the parish, Catholic parish of Hermes, who the local community called us, because, well, they had some archaeological sites in the mountain. This is a catalog from 2011, but in fact it was done during the 90s, so very long time ago. But there were some interesting things like rock art, in granite, we are specialized in rock art, and then megaliths, dolmens, this beautiful tumuli necropolis, and well, why not? Let's study this mountain. And then, well, we found something different that it's here. But first, well, we did some survey with the students. This started in 2016 until today. And survey with the students, with the local community explaining to us where the sites were. This is not catalog, this is a new one, and so on. With the people, the local people knew about it much better than us. And we did some cleaning, we did some photo with artificial light, of course. This is the rock art from the Bronze Age, probably. And, well, some cleaning of the rocks also, because, well, the cleaning is important because of forest fires are the main risk in this kind of places, no? And then discovering new ones. We discovered that during the construction of the wind farm, there was no very good job, if I have to say it this way, no? So many sites were neglected. In North, they were not discovered during the construction. We did some, of course, documentation with digital techniques, but also traditional documentation, because it was important. This is not needed from the point of view of science, but it's important from the social point of view. We had an authorization from our superintendenza for doing this, and for doing even a mold, traditional mold, for rock carving, and giving this, giving it back to the community. The community was, of course, they were getting money from the wind farm, but they were the place was partially destroyed. So they were like, so it was an idea of giving it back. No? And the local community, talking about place names, talking about folklore, talking about everything. This is the really important part for archaeology, for me. Much more important in material part than the material. They are linked, but they are important. And this is the why I'm going to talk here. There was a special place. They talked to us. They said, some people say there was a hill for there from the Iron Age. There is no hill for there are no walls. Yeah, but there are something. The archaeologists said there is nothing, but we are sure there is something there. And then we approached the site, and something was there. Yes, that's true. Here, here. Well, nowadays it is, of course, the opening of the the road cut, and then this is parking today, and the base of the windmill, and well, the LiDAR, as you can see, there was something there, no, isn't it? There was something there, but talking with the, with our regional government, they said, no, it was a study, there's nothing, no, the archaeologists say, no, there's nothing there. This is the necropolis, this is the tumuli, you can see them there. And then this is public data. This was processed by us, but it's public. So, in fact, I'm going to show. It is very easy, so easy to do this. It's here. To do this, to see the place, to. This is a Hilford from the Iron Age. This here, as you can see. Of course, this is one. There is another one there, there is, well, tumuli, some sites, but the problem was this site here. Well, here there is a huge quarry, as you can see, but the problem was this site. So it was clear from the beginning. Well, this was after the beginning. This image, we got it after some time, processing data in some different ways and so on, and we get to this. But it was not enough for some archaeologists. They said, no, there's nothing there. But we went and we found prehistoric pottery for sure. So what happened here? But we needed to prove it. So the first part of diagnosis is there is something here. We had a problem because talking with colleagues, they said, no, some people studied it, there's nothing there. And the old photographs, we thought, what can we do? So let's look at a thermal camera from a drone, too expensive. A LiDAR, but detailed LiDAR, too expensive. GeoRadar, maybe with some university, but the ground was difficult, too many rocks. What to do to prove it? Only excavating, but we have no money. So we needed to prove it with just on our own, without financial funding from nothing. No? So some images, some old images, the image was there, but not enough. Sorry, but it's here, but it is something. Okay, what we did, taking QGIS, some had the idea of getting old photographs from the 70s. We have in Spain a very bad documentation from aerial photography, but from the 70s, 80s, there are some layers there in black and white. Some of them are good, some of them are not. And using, we were lucky because they intertwine quite well. We were lucky to have some different coincidence in the same place. And in the end, we were able to reconstruct the place before the windmill. And it was like showing it to our superintendent. Okay, here it was. We are sure this is not a Hilford. It's an enclosure, a henge, whatever. It's another kind of prehistoric site, but it was there for sure. We know how it was before the destruction. This is why this is the point I wanted to show today. It's very simple, but it was enough. We can reconstruct the landscape from old photographs, huh? Exaggerating, giving more height and different kinds of local relief model and so on. And of course, after that, the project started and we were able to clean the vegetation, that it was one of the problems. And now with the drone, you can see perfectly the place. So, why not to fly the drone before? In part because of the windmills, in part because without cleaning the vegetation, you won't see anything. And because this is, well, traditional restoration technique, grazing light. No? So, it's very easy. In the end, traditional techniques are there for us. And in part, there is a problem. The community wanting to protect the site is this one. But this is the limit and the border. The circle is divided in the middle, and then this community, they don't want to protect the site. They did this to put them eucalyptus trees very recently, and so on. And this was the problem. The place we were able to excavate in the end, after proving it was an archaeological site, it was this that this almost destroyed. You can see here the stones from the explosions and so on. This is the site. This is the site again. This is the necropolis. These are the eucalypts. This is the site here. And again, of course, drone. At the beginning of our project, drones were quite expensive. But 4 years later, 5 years later, it was not that expensive. So there are many, many things that in 5 years' time for archaeology has changed a lot. And the question is, what happened during the wind farm environmental and archaeological impact assessment? Because there was there an impact assessment. What happened during that phase? It's difficult to explain. Of course, it is the condition how the companies work, how they are poorly funded, is not enough time, not enough people working, and not because of their fault. And also, well, many reasons. It was one of the first wind farms in our region. And then this kind of sites, of course, Stonehenge in the British Isles, they are very famous, Stonehenge, the circles. This kind of enclosures are perfectly known in other parts of Europe, but not in our region. So at the time, in 1999, 2002, it was very difficult to recognize it. Avebury is probably the most famous one in Europe, no? But there are many, many more. Ritual sites with different kinds of occupation during prehistory. And in the British Isles, they are known, but in Galicia there was one, and it was destroyed by a highway. And the excavation, they said the chronology is medieval, so it is not prehistoric, so the regional government thought it was the same, let's say that. So that's another reason. Well, it's too difficult to explain why, but it happened in the end. Nowadays, we know some more. Nowadays, they are appearing like mushrooms, you know, one and another, and another one, and another one in our region. Once you know what you are looking for, it is there for you to find it. But you need to know what you are looking for first. With the help of the private company in archaeology, well, they did a couple of excavations, and of course there is a structure, of course, lots of prehistoric pottery. We are waiting for datations, C14 and so on, but if, of course, it is a prehistoric site, no doubt. Bronze Age, more or less, Chalcolithic, maybe Neolithic in the beginning, we are not sure, but anyway. And well, last we wanted to talk to the people, because this destruction was a huge impact for the people. So the idea is to the local community, involve them, and they are a key part of the project. And of course, the not only talks, but exchanging of communication, information, and so on. And in the mountain, in the whole hill or the whole mountain, there are much more. There are another one, a chapel from the Middle Age, from the 15th century, was also forgotten. It was not destroyed by chance, because you can see, but it's a chapel from the 15th century, and the people knew about that. There was the place name, but in archaeology, in the past, we didn't look at ethnographical heritage. So that was the problem of this impact assessment, forgetting the folklore and the place names and the people, I guess. And then, well, some ideas what we did, and with the help of the local people, again, some tracks and, well, some routes to discover your heritage and so on. And apart from that, we are involved in nature and heritage from monuments. Like, this is not, for sure this was used during prehistory, but it's not, was never excavated, so probably there will be some kind of activity there. But when you talk about archaeology, you need to talk about both together, nature and culture. And well, finally, This is the site. After all these years, we now what are we doing with it? And so we are finally we proved it. It's a site, and let's protect it. Maybe what we can do, and so on. No, we are very slow, but we are doing something for conservation and restoration. Someday, maybe we can restore this. Oof. Oof. But the future is this, because there are new projects, lots of them in Galicia, lots of them, lots of projects. And at this time, it's like the whole of Galicia nowadays, these months, this year, there are new projects. And there is a new one in the same mountain again. So we measure everything against the cathedral. We measure everything against, in Galicia, against Santiago de Compostela. So, Ravenna is a beautiful town. Yeah, compared with Santiago, yeah, it is. No, in this case, look at the size of the towers, and look at the size of the new windmill. So, of course, we want green power, of course, but archaeology needs to be involved in those debates, because if not, we are risking to commit the same mistakes again. Some references from, well, our colleagues from the Spanish research, from GIS, Inspire, so on. Our colleagues from the University of Santiago working with these ritual sites, and our colleague archaeologists working with photogrammetry and so on. And that's all. Fale minderit, grazie mille. And this is the team from this year. Thank you.
Presentation, which compared to Santiago was, I think, equal interesting for us. So I'd like to ask the audience if do you have any questions for Álvaro?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
I loved the way you involved the community in this, and we usually don't hear about that. And I wanted to know, like, how did you do it? Like, did you launch an appeal? How was it done?
Well, it was the local community who approached us, our school. It happens sometimes, like these kind of communal properties, they need some assessment, some help relating archaeological sites and so on. So it's quite common to give advice to sometimes municipalities or... Yeah. We are the only institution apart from the regional government, we are the only institution in Galicia, in our region, in conservation and restoration. So, some of them do it. So they were really, really involved, this community. Not the others, the neighbors, some of them were into archaeology, some of them, they are not at all. They don't want archaeology at all, because... Yeah.
Why would they be opposed to it?
Why are they opposed?
Why are they completely opposed?
First, because neighbors sometimes are always enemies. This is the first reason. The other one, it is because if you understand development only from an economical point of view and from the point of view of windmills are giving us money, I want more windmills. Some people think in a different way, more in the long term. But if you think in the short term, so I think some of the communities are thinking on a very short term, and yeah.
I have a question.
Yes.
Do you have anthropologists in your group? Because I think the whole study that you've done with a community is very interesting.
Anthropologists we don't have, because in Spain the anthropological studies are not are very recent. So some of the archaeologists working, myself for instance, we are working with anthropology, but I don't have a bachelor degree in anthropology, but at least 2-3 of them are very involved in anthropology in general. But trained anthropologists? No, we don't. We don't. But we try to do, it's like, you know, we try to do like conservation. Of course, we have conservators, of course.
So, several times you have been approaching anthropology, like talking with the people of the community and taking some facts from them.
Because our landscape archaeology team in Galicia is quite strong and it's very linked to anthropological studies. So, yeah, it's a common approach for us. Anthropology and archaeology link, like in England, for instance. Yeah.
Another question?
Yes, I have a little question. But first of all, I want to say thank you for your presentation. I really appreciate it. I see in one of your first slides that you are looking for a virtual restoration or something else.
Yeah.
And I'm asking you the project or what you are looking for, because they're the project of Eloica and they're not way to excavation more.
Yeah. When I said virtual restoration, I was thinking on the reconstruction of the circle,
mm-hmm.
first, from old photographs and from memories, from the people, from interviews with the people talking about the site, how it was. I think for immaterial heritage in the sense of anthropological inquiries and virtual with digital tools, both of them. What are we going to do next? We don't know.
Okay.
We don't know still.
No, because I am thinking about using some software to rebuild the structure.
Yeah. For me, of maybe removing that windmill and then creating something there, that could be an idea. Could be an idea. Yeah. Museum of the enclosures and hens. using the damage for good. You know, like something like that. I'm not sure. At least this case is like a warn. Is warning us. Take care with it.
Any other questions? I think we have more questions. Thank you again, Alvaro. It was really, really interesting, especially the focus on the community engagement that I think should always be stressed and reminded when we deal with archaeology and archaeological sites. So thank you.
Thanks to you.
And now we are moving on to conclusions of this study.